So in the previous class, we did talk about the some introduction about the job concept. We talked about the different features, the advantages of the having the Java language, and along with that, we talked about the different concept of the object-oriented programming, that is, encapsulation, polymorphism, inheritance, and so on. Today we talk about that how to write a program in the Java. So here you can see one of the simple program written in the Java. So as we are saying till now that all the files that you store on the computer system, they are having the extension of the three letters like .exe, .doc, .xls, .com and all those. So all the file having the extension in the file name with the three letters. But when we save the file in the Java, so in this case we have to save the file with the extension .java. So here we will get the name of the file with the four character extension. In this, we have written this code into the notepad. Although there are the various kind of the editors are available in which you can write this Java program, or you can use the Eclipse also that having the compiler as well as the editor available there over there. But till now we are using the notepad to write the program, and we will compile this program over the command prompt. So in this case the program is written like this. Here when we save the file with the, so in the case of the C++ or in the other languages, you have seen that whenever you write a program, you can save that file with the some any random length. Like for example, if you are making a program for the addition of two numbers, and you can save the file with the name abc.c or a.c or b.c or any random name you can give over there. So there is no such rule over there to assign the name of the file. But in case of the Java, when we have to save the file, then we should remember that the name of the file should match with the name of the class in which we are having the main function available. The reason to assign the same name of the file as the name of the class is that when you compile the file, so after the compilation you will get the file name as a the name of the class dot class. Like for example, in this we have made the class name as a hello. So when we compile this file, so we will get the file with the name hello dot class. The name of the program is, name of the file is hello dot java. And after the compilation, we will get the hello.class as an intermediate file having the bytecode. Now, when we have to run the file, so at that time we have to remember the name of the file that we have to run should match with the name of the program that we have given. The reason is that if, like in this program, we have written only single class file, but there are the programs in which we are having more than one class file. Suppose some program is having a 10 class file. So when you compile the program, so at that time you are getting the 10 different files for every class that you make in the program. Every class that you make, for every class you are getting file with the extension dot class. So in this case, we are getting the 10 different class files as a result. Now out of those 10 files, which file you have to run? How you have to remember that? So to make it convenient for the user, the method we are adopting, that name of the class should match with the name of the file. So after the compilation, which file you have to run, that should match with the name of the program that you have given over there. So that's why we assign the name of the file and the name of the class should match in which we are having the main function. Now this is the way we have written the program. Here is we have said that all the things are defined in the terms of the class and the objects. As we said that Java is a complete object-oriented programming language. Here everything that you write is in the form of class and the objects. We cannot write anything outside of the class. So here, even if you have to write the main function, then the main function is also written within the class. So this is the body of the class, starting from opening curly braces to the closing curly braces. Here class is the keyword, hello is the identifier. Identifier is by which we identify this class within our system. Anything that you want to do, that should be written within the opening and closing curly braces. Now here, this is the way we write the main function. Public static void main. Now, what is the use of every keyword over here? Public. Public means it is known as access modifier. Means which indicate that what thing we are able to access and where we are able to access. So when we say public, means our main function is visible throughout our system. Anywhere it can be accessible. So we want that the main should be visible outside of a class to the JVM, because JVM is there which is going to execute our program, and main is the starting point from where the execution of our program gets started. So main should be written as a public, then only the JVM should able come to know that there is a main function available in the program. If you have not written the main as a public, then it is simply default access visibility and the JVM is not able to access that thing. Or if you made it the private, again, in that case, it is visible only within the class. It is not accessible outside of the class. So in that case, the JVM will not able to come to know about the presence of the main function in the program. So our program will not get executed. Although it will get compiled, but it will not get executed. So we want our program to get executed, and the main is the starting point for the execution. So it should be declared as a public. Next is static. As we all know that the member of a class are accessed outside of a class with the buffer object. What are the members available, whether it's a variables or the functions? All those things are accessible outside of a class only with the buffer object. Object name dot the member name. Right. Now, but here, as our class is not compiled till now, main is starting execution, so there is no availability of the object. Object is not created till now, and the main should get executed without the object. So in that case, if we want that our main should execute, our main should be accessible outside of a class without the help of the object, in that case we should declare as a static. So anything that is declared as a static is accessible outside of a class without the help of the object. So main is always executed without the help of the object, because till now there is no object available for this class. Why is that? As we have seen with the other programming languages also, that the function returns some value. What is the operation that is performed by the function? The operation, the result is written back from that function to its caller. Now main is again the function. Now what the main will return? Here main is not returning anything. So in that case, we have defined it as a void. Void indicate that main is, it is not returning anything. But if the main want to return something, then you have to give that particular kind of the data type, like integer, float and small. So in this case, the main is not returning anything. Okay. Next is that, as we have seen with the other languages, that in the C and C++ we have seen that generally we don't pass anything to the main function. That's why we write main and the empty bracket. But here, if we want that we want to pass something to the main function from the command prompt or the command line argument, so in that case, we have to specify the set of parameters. As we said, the main is the function, and anything that you want to pass to the function, that has to be done with the parameters. So here, we are given the set of parameters with the main, that is string ARKS and the empty bracket. Empty is parameter. So that is saying that string is a class. ARKS is, it is known as the array of object of the class string. It is known as array of object of the class string. So anything that you pass, that will get copied to the respective array elements of the string class. Now within the main, this thing we return, this same as we are using the printf in the C or the cout in the C++. So anything that you have to display on the screen, that has to be done with the help of this system. System.out.println, where println is a function that is defined within the package out, and out is defined within the class system. So system is a class, out is the subclass, and return. So system is the having all the related operation that is performed over the system, that is all the input operation and the output operation. Like system.out, that is dealing with all the output device, output operation. In the same way, system.in, so that is dealing with the all the input or the anything that you want to get from the user. And here, anything that you want to display, that should be placed within the bracket, within the double quotes. So let's see how to compile the program. Here, this is the one simple program we are taking. This is the class hello, public static void main string args system.out.println hello. This is the closing of class, this is the closing of main function. Now here we have to save the program. So how to save? This is save as. Here we give the name of the file is a hello.java. Here we give the name is hello.java because the name of the class is the same as hello. So name of the class and the name of the program should match over here. So save the file. We have saved the file. Okay. Now at the command prompt, how to compile and how to run. So in this, first we have to set the path. So path is set like this. Path is that where we have to show that where our Java compiler is available. When the Java compiler is available, actually into the bin folder of the Java. So we have to give the path about that bin folder where it is available. So path equals to percent path. Percent path percent is that we want to include all the previous path that has been set by the operating system and the various applications. So we are including all those things that is done by the percent path percent, then semicolon, and here we have to give the name of our path that we have to add. So C colon slash Java. This. So this is the path we have given that our bin folder is available in the program file, Java, JDK and the bin. Or you can give the path on according to your system. So here we have set the path. Now here, when we have to compile the program, it is done with the help of Java C. Here Java C is the Java compiler, and here the name of the file that we have created. Hello.java. So we will compile this. If some error is there, the error will get displayed, otherwise it will show. Let's see the name of the file that is created here. Here the file that is created is hello.class. This is the file that we created, hello.java. In the same way for this file we got the hello.class file. So as I told you that every file, every class that is available in our program, for every class we are getting the separate file by the name of that class dot the class extension. Now this is the class file that we have to run. So for running this we have to write Java and hello. Name of the Java, by that we have to execute and the name of the program. So here we can see the result. This is the hello that we want to display. So this thing has been displayed over here like this. In the same way, if you want to print some variable, for example, if you say integer I is equals to 10, we declare the variable integer and we want to display the value of this variable. So it is done like this. Hello. Value of I is equals to, it is done like this. Here, what are the things that you have to display? That has to be written within the double quotes. Now, if you want to display the value of a variable, so either we can display the value of variable directly Like for example, if you say here integer j is equals to 20, system.out.println and the j. So if you have to display value of variable only, then we can write here like this. Simply write the name of the variable that you want to display. But if you want some string also along with the variable value, then we have to written like this. This is a string that you want to display. Then we have to use the plus operator and the name of a variable. What the plus will do? That plus, the value of I was converted from integer to string equivalent. Then this string is concatenated with the help of the plus operator with the other string. So this string plus the value of I in the form of the string, they both get concatenated by the plus operator and the whole string gets displayed on the output device. Otherwise, you want to display the value of variable only, then we can write in this way. Let's see how it will show the result. Again, compile it and then run it. So here we can see the value of I is this and the another. This is the things. System is a predefined class which provides access to the console, and out is related with the output stream that is connected to the console. So that's why we are using system.out.println. println is a function. The println function is including ln. We are saying ln at the last. So what the ln indicate? Ln is showing the new line character. So new line character is included in this. Otherwise you can use simply a print. So ln include the new line character means this string will get displayed and the new line character is added over there. Now Java is having different kind of lexical issues available with it. By that whole Java compiler is different design. There is a white space, identifiers, then literals, keywords. These are literals, comments, and the separators are the and the Java keywords. These are so many things are available that constitute the whole Java language. So white space is that we are able to write the complete Java program in a single line itself. But to make it more clarify, make it more clear, and to and the user can identify it or understand it very easily, we have to use the different white spaces. So what are the different white spaces? That is tape or the space character or and the new line character. By that we can make it our program more clear. Identifiers are those by which you can identify the class name, method name, variable name within the program. So the way that you assign the name to the class or to the function or to the variable, that is known as the identifier. By that the class is identified within the program. That is the meaning of the identifiers. So we can assign the name either in the lowercase or in the uppercase, or the combination of the letters, numbers, underscores, and the dollar sign to design any identifiers. But this identifiers should not begin with the any name, number. Like these are some identifiers being given. We can use capital letter or the smallest letter. We can use combination of the characters and the numbers. We can start the identifiers with the dollar sign. We can use the underscore, but we cannot start with the number. This is invalid. We cannot use the hyphen sign over here. This is invalid. We cannot use the other any other character over here. This is invalid. Then the literals. Literals are the constant value that has been created using the literal representation of it. Constant value, like this is the integer constant, this is the real constant, this is the character constant, this is the string constant. The string is written within double quotes, characters are written within the single quotes. The comments, there are three different types of the comments over here, but here it doesn't, we are showing only the two types. This is known as the single line comment, this is known as the multi line comment. If you want to place so many lines is a form of the comment. So we are using the multi-line over here. All those styles are placed within this opening and the closing. Then the separators. Separators is by which we can separate the statements or the variables or the things. Then this is the small bracket. Small bracket means where we are saying this small bracket when we are using some mathematical expression or when we are writing the name of the parameters with the function name. So at that time we are using this thing to make it separate. This is the curly braces, opening and closing curly braces. This is generally used when we are designing a method function or we are creating some class. So opening and closing curly braces or we are creating some block. So anything that you written within this will be a form separators. This is the square bracket. This square bracket is used when we are using the array. With the array we use this thing. Then this is the semicolon. This semicolon is used when we have to terminate the statement. At the end of the array statement we are using semicolon. This is a comma. Comma is used when we are using the different, so we have to declare so many variables and we have to separate those variable declarations. So we are using the variable name, comma, another variable name, comma and so on. This is a dot operator. Dot operator is used when we have to use the sum function from some class. So we are using class name dot the function name, are we using object name dot the variable name or object name dot the function name, or we dot operator is also used when we have to use the package dot sub package dot the function and so on. Then Java is having around 50 keywords available, like if, else, while, do while and so on, class and all those. These are all the different keywords available. There is around total 50 keywords are available in the Java. Then we are seeing that the Java is a strictly typed language. Means, as we had said about the one of the features of the Java, there is a robustness. Robustness is saying that all the kind of the errors has been solved during the compile time and during the runtime, so that there is no further chance to get any error in future. So why we are saying Java is a strictly typed language? Because every variable that you define is having a type. Every expression that you write is having a certain type. Every type is strictly defined. All the errors have been solved during the compile time. All the errors are solved during the runtime. Whenever we do some assignment, whether we assign it explicitly, explicitly means when we say let's say some variable equals to some value, there is the explicit assignment, or we are doing it with the help of the parameter passing. So in that case, parameter passing is when we are doing the method call or the function call. So at that time, all of those variables and their variables are values and the variables are checked for their type compatibility. Whether the value that we are assigned to those variables are compatible or not. If it is not compatible, then it will generate the error during the compile time itself. So once we have solved those errors, then there is no further chance of getting those errors. So all the assignments are checked for their type compatibility. There is no automatic conversion of the config types. Like if you are assigning the value from the double to an integer, then there is no automatic conversion taking place. We cannot assign the value from higher data type to the lower data type. So in that case, the system will generate the errors and give the user the chance to resolve the errors during the compile time itself. Java has defined the various kind of the data types. There are the 8 simple data types are available in the Java. That is the byte, short, int, long. These are within the integer category. Then the character, then float, double, and the boolean. So the various groups are available here. Within the integer groups, we are in the byte, short, int, and the long. In the floating point categories, we are in the float and the double. Then in the character we are in the character data type, in the boolean we are in the boolean data types. So these are the some inbuilt or the system defined data types are available. In the integer category, the size that is in the amplifier, like the byte is the lowest one or the shortest one, so that amplifies the 8 bit, short 16 bit, integer 32 bit along 64 bit. This size of this variable remains fixed whether you run the Java or the Windows environment or the Apple environment or the Linux environment or any environment that you take. There the size of this data type always remains same. But in case of the C or the C++, you have seen that when you the compiler for the Linux is having a different data type size, compiler for the Windows is having a different data type size. So then the size is varying, that's why the problem we are getting are the portability. But in the case of the Java, there is no such problem of the portability. And these are the various range available over here. In the case of the C and C++, we are saying that there we are having the unsigned integer. Means if you want to store only the positive value and we don't have any negative value, then we can define the unsigned integer. But in the case of the Java, there is no such concept of the unsigned integer. Here the values are in the negative also as well as in the positive also. In the case of the float category, we are in the data type float in the double. Float occupy the 32 bit, double occupy the 64 bit. Then the character. Character is having 16 bit, other 2 byte over here. In the case of the C and C++, we have seen that there we are having a character data type of the 1 byte only. And the number of characters that can be accumulated over there is 0 to 255. This total 256 characters can be accumulated over there. That is known as the RC character sets. But in case of the, as we are saying that Java is a universal language, so in this we are having the character sets available for the different languages can be accumulated over here. Here we are able to design the program for the Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Russian, or any language that you take of the world. All of those languages characters can be written over here. So that's why we are saying the Java is a universal language. So to accommodate all of those characters, the size we require over here is our 16 bit. And here the character sets that we are taking is the Unicode. Unicode that include the characters of all the languages. Here the English language characters is also accommodated over here, but the range that we had seen in the case of the ASCII, the same range is available for the in the Unicode. Means if you say in the case of the ASCII, 65 is there to represent the A, so in the Unicode also 65 is there to represent the A. So the same kind of representation is available. Then another is the Boolean. Boolean is, as we are saying, there are two possible values, either the true or the false. In the case of the integer, if you have to represent the, let's say the value in the case of the octal, then that has to be written as 0, and the means that number should be started with a 0 to represent the value in the form of octal. And if you have to represent the number in the case of hexadecimal, then it has to be written like 0x and that value. The variables, as you know, that variables are that the values keep on changing about those variables. So the variables are written like this. Here it is a data type, here the name of the variable and the value. This value is optional whether we want to assign it with the declaration or not, but we do write the data type of that and the name of that variable. So type is the Java is argument type, that is the name of the class or the interface. Here that variable that you can define of either of the system defined data types, or you can define the variables of a class, or you can define variable of the interface. Identifier is the name of a variable. It is initialized the variable by assign an equal sign and the variable. We use the comma or separator for more than one variable declaration. Like for example, if you have to declare more than one variable, then it is written integer a, comma b, comma and c. It is only the variable declaration. If you want to assign the value with the declaration, so it can be written like data type, name of a variable equals to the value. Like in the C and C++, we have seen that all the variables that you want to use, that has to be declared at the top of the program. Just after the main, we are declaring all the variables that is required in the our program. But in case of the Java, there is no such need that all the variables should be declared at the top. We can declare the variable wherever the requirement is there. In the same statement, we can write the variable and we can declare that variable wherever the requirement is covered. So there is no such need to write the all the variables at the top of the program. Like here, we can see. Here we have declared the two variables A and B at the top. Now there is a requirement of the another variable C. So we can declare the variable here in the same statement. So there is known as the dynamic initialization. That is, declare the variable and initialize the variable wherever the requirement is there. Here the square root is the function that has been taken from the class myth. Then with the variable we are going to construct the scope and the lifetime of the variable. The scope is defined whenever we are creating a block. Block is created by creating opening and closing curly braces. So whenever we create a block by opening and curly braces, so block defines the scope of an object or the scope of a variable. So every time whenever we start a new block, we create a new scope. And the scope determines that which objects are visible to the other part of the program. Means anything that you declare within the block, that is visible only within that block. It is not visible outside of the block. So block is creating the constant of the encapsulation or the data heading, or it provides the constant of the protection. Then anything that you written within that block is protected. It is not visible or it is not accessible outside of the block. So it also determines the life of those objects. Means anything that you declare within the object, within those opening and closing curly braces or within that scope, that is visible only within that block and it is having lifetime only for that particular block. As the block is over, as the control comes out of that block, then that variable gets destroyed. Like here, we can see the one of the example. Here we have declared the variable x, we assign the value x equals to 10. Then we check if x equals to 10, condition is true. Then we have started opening curly braces. And this is the closing of this if. Now within this opening and closing, we have declared another variable y. Integer y equals to 20, we have declared the variable. So we are able to use this variable y within this opening and closing curly braces only. It is visible or having the lifetime only for that particular block. If you want to use this variable outside of this block, like for example we written here y equals to 100. The y is declared within this block and we are trying to access this variable outside of this block y equals to 100. So here it will generate the error because y is not known here. It is not visible over here. So that's why we are getting the error. So here y is having the visibility only for this particular block. So anything, the variable x is declared outside of this block, but x is visible here. Anything that is declared in the outside of the block is visible in the nested block. But anything that you declare in the nested block is not visible outside of it. So variables are created when their scope is entered or when their opening curly braces is started, and it will destroy when the scope is left or when the closing curly braces is occur. Lifetime of variable is also confined to its scope. Like here, we can see here, whenever we enter within this for loop, suppose first time x is 0, so we enter within this block, y is initialized, y is created, and it is initialized with the minus 1. Then within this block, we modify the value of y with the 100, y is printed over here with the 100. Then again, the control comes over here. And x become the 1. Now as the control comes, means as we come out of this opening and closing curly braces, the y will be destroyed. Again next time for x equals to 1, y again initialized with the minus 1. Y is again created, it initialized with the minus 1. Then again y become 100. Then again when the closing curly braces occur, it gets destroyed. Again when it comes at the top, again for the value of x equals to 2, again the y gets created. So the lifetime of a variable is, as the scope is over, it will get destroyed and again it get recreated next time. Along with that, if we declare some variable in the outer scope, then we cannot declare the same variable in the nested scope. otherwise it will generate an error. As we can see that in the outer scope we declare the variable and the same variable we declare in the nested scope, so it will generate the error over there. So that's all for today.